This 40-foot high cube shipping container is going to take an entire northern community off the grid. 3 acres of solar panels are going to be plugged into this unit. Plus, it has 2 heavy diesel generators inside of this. And for this thing not to settle into the sand, we had to build a heavy-duty oil field skid. So that is going to hold all of the weight that's inside of this thing, all the inverters, all the batteries. It's going to work out so well. But in order to access these diesel generators, we had to modify the side of the shipping container with standard height shipping container doors. We've cut these off of a previous set of containers on a previous mod and were able to reuse them. We had to add louvered vents into the doors, and we also have ventilation coming up from underneath the container, and that's going to deal with exhausting all the heat that's generated from these generators. Only one will be running at a time. The second is a layer of redundancy. So let's check it out, what it looks like inside. So in here, here's the 2 generators. This is awesome. We have used our hazardous material containment cans to sit underneath these things. So if ever there was all the antifreeze or oil that was to spill out of these things, the ground is protected, and that's super important. We do a ton of hazardous material storage modifications here at the Container Guy. And it was really fun to do this mod because we were able to play around with things that are new to us, like installing exhaust pipes and having them exit out of the shipping container. And we were able to do that with our new, we call it a nominally vertical recessed frame. And this box, it allows any type of utility to pass into shipping containers. So here we have one and it's a blank. There's nothing drilled through here yet, but all the diesel fuel is gonna be a huge diesel tank that feeds into here that's gonna feed those generators, and then the exhausts come out the top. And on the other side, we have 2 more frames. One's going to be bringing in, there's solar panels on the sidewall and on the roof of the shipping container. Those are not necessarily used for the production of energy for the community, but those are just backup solar panels to feed the UPS in here. That's going to be the SOS of the whole system. If everything else went down, at least we'll have some power to communicate with this thing here in our local city, because it is going to be far away. And so here's those boxes here. This is going to be high voltage power that feeds the community. It's going to be generating 208, I'm not sure if single phase or 3 phase, we will ask the client when we get there. And up there is all of the lower voltage cabling coming in. There's also going to be 2 sources of internet going to this thing for a layer of redundancy. So if the Starlink wasn't working, we'll still have a 5G source of internet, because this community is all electric. They do not have any natural gas, so this is their lifeline. It's the only source of heat all winter long at that community, and it cannot break down. And so we've added so many layers of redundancy, and that's here what these strut channels on this sidewall. This will be facing south. We are going to be mounting panels. We used our exterior MSS brackets, so that allows us to strut line the exterior, and then up top on certain areas, we've actually went across the roof, and then others we didn't. Up on the roof, it's mostly going to be the internet and other things being mounted on there. And then this, we are just going to straight vertical, 90 degrees, mount our solar panels. It's way north, so it will catch the sun. Basically, they don't even want them to flare out. We have our amazing kit that allows you 1 panel at a time to pull them out and vary the pitch and follow the sun. So as you get further south, you want to get more on a flatter angle, so to speak. The generators are at the back of the container, but there's a 2-hour fire separation. There's a partition wall that separates the nuts and bolts of this container. So all of the electrical components are going to be in the 3/4, that's all insulated. And this here is super well insulated. There's 5 inches of spray foam in here. We did an R30 system, and there's still in the summertime going to be a ton of heat produced. And that's where our 16-inch exhaust fans come into play. We have these here that will kick in. You can set the humidity or the temperature at high and low parameters. So they have a very intuitive controller on them, manage multiple things, and they're self-sustaining. They're awesome DC inverted, so they're very efficient on power as well. And these here need intakes, obviously. So in the floor of the container, towards the back, towards that partition wall, is going to be some intake vents there where we can actually pull low air and go up and out, and that's for summertime only. We're still waiting on the components, but we're gonna have insulated plugs, so to speak, that will close this off. And throughout the winter, we don't need the ventilation. We don't want that cold draft going through the shipping container. So we'll block off the intakes, block off the exhaust, and there'll be a procedure every springtime, every fall, to switch it into winter summer mode. Now, if we move on to the back end of the container, you'll notice that the skid is 3 feet long on this side. And we do that to kind of protect the condenser boxes for the mini splits here. So these are 2 3-ton mini split heat pumps. They'll do air conditioning plus they'll heat, and they're super efficient. We love them. And we have 2 of them for redundancy. So they're separate with separate head units on the inside. So typically we only really need one, but we have that extra layer of redundancy in this unit. And we'll be bringing all of the refrigerant lines and the powers that go from the condensers to the head units through our nominally vertical frame. And we call it nominally vertical because it's 47 degrees instead of 45. And that allows us to get past all of the national building codes, provincial building codes, municipal codes. So it seems to work great and really is an awesome product that I want to get released to the public. So keep an eye out for that. And here we've done our same modular exterior system, so to speak, where we've strut lined it using the same MSS exterior brackets and then our traditional shelving brackets. Something new that we did here, they're very low cost, is these rubber isolator mounts, and then vibrations from these things. They're actually very, very quiet, but on heat mode, they do vibrate more than on cool. That'll just keep the vibrations down inside of here. Who knows if the inverters or anything wouldn't like that, or they're sensitive to that. And so that there is how we mount these condenser boxes externally. We also have a recessed condenser box frame that we use in other applications where we can't have the container be wider or longer than its existing 8x40 dimensions. So if we come over to this side here, we have one more of the 16-inch exhaust fans. So that's added a layer of redundancy again. We only really needed one of them, but we got one on each side. So if one fails, got the other. Here we've installed, actually we've slightly changed our 36-inch dual swinger man door here. This is a universal man door. It can be installed as either a left or a right just by rotating it and changing the top rain drip on it. But what we've done here is we've actually analyzed this thing. I always assumed that this door frame would weaken the structure of the container, but there's an allowable amount of structure that we can weaken the container and still pass all wind loads and snow loads for any jurisdiction. But what I found out after we ran our finite element analysis is that it actually makes the container slightly stronger. So super excited to hear that. The only thing we had to do is add another rivet just down in the bottom corner and up at the top. But now you know, even without the door slab in here, once this frame is installed, the container is slightly stronger than it was prior to having the frame in there. So that's awesome. That's great news. This here, we actually had the pros come help us install this. We did a little lunch and learn and we learned from them, but they loved our door frame. They see a lot of applications for this, whether it's on metal Quonsets or sheds, other things where you just have a fully assembled door, walk up to a flat building, screw it on, walk away. And so it was great to have them give us some pro tips on how to adjust these doors. Sometimes containers are bowed and it flexes with the frame and then we get weird openings. But we mitigate a lot of that by using an automotive door seal. So we use the side bulb seal here and that can move and twist. These are not buildings. These are more of like a semi-trailer. They're getting moved all the time. And with traditional door seal, that would pop off. That sucked. So that was a great find for us, is to use an automotive door seal. This here, because there's high voltage in here, we need the panic bar and then a self-closing device. We tried to use the highest grade we could. And yeah, I'll just see that thing in action. Oh yeah. And with these doors and with that automotive door seal, we really need the door to slam to set that seal. Even when it's just a handle, someone's really got to give it one. And I think as it gets utilized in that, that virgin rubber gets compressed more and more, then the doors get easier to operate. And with this panic hardware, we can actually get the regular lever trim and it can be lockable. So we can just lock with the key and then we have our universal lock box. So it's very similar to our container lock box, but it can be rotated left and right. So it's got holes in the top and bottom. And then you can lock this just like how you lock the regular shipping container doors. One thing I want to show you as we're walking is our oil field skids have a 12x4 rectangular tube in them, instead of just pipes all the way along as cross members. And then that allows us now to lift this thing with a forklift. We want to be careful with this unit, but that skid does distribute the weight, plus the strength of the wall allows us to lift this now if you have a heavy enough forklift. I think this whole thing here is gonna be like 35,000 pounds. It's crazy. So you see these old shipping container doors, they got the lock boxes on them. These open up. This is actually something I really wanna show you, is that it took us 2 tries to get this right. We first processed this framing kit out of mild steel and thicker gauge steel and had to switch. We went back down to a 10 gauge galvanized, which worked, and that eliminated a lot of the welding and the warping. We even learned actually a lot of these hinges on the containers, they're wonky, they're everywhere. And so it took a lot of fine tuning and adjusting to get that right, but we did get it right and they do work. And we tried to make a bolt-on system. So these hinges actually use carriage bolts and bolt right on. Same with the frame. So we're able to assemble everything on the floor using gravity. And that is super important. If you try to do this vertically and get everything to fit, I tried it once, took like a week doing it on the floor. Takes a day, even though this took a week. But we learned a lot and we got a kit developed out of it. We also just got some, instead of the regular big cast keepers, we were able to fold that out of sheet metal, and it seems to work as well. It's a little bit finicky here and there if the container's twisted, but we can refine that. And if we can have just a fully laser cut, bent, processed framing kit that allows us to install standard shipping container doors on the sides of a high cube, that's gonna be mint. So here we are, we're back at the start. We can close up the doors. And finally, look at that. This container modification world lockbox. These look so mint. These are black powder coated, and that allows us to get a 80 millimeter shackle lock in there. We could get those key to like, so we can put the universal lockbox on the man door and then have these on the 3 sets of shipping container doors, 4 locks, 1 set of keys, because you can get all key to like. That's great. So our work here is done now. We actually need to get this out of our shop. It needs to go to our client's shop. They got to install all the guts inside of this thing. After that's done, we're going to be able to go get a tour of it. And also, hopefully, we can pick their brain and learn a lot from them. Stay tuned.